Hello everyone, welcome. I'm going to go ahead and now take this wonderful opportunity to introduce my friend and cherished colleague, Danielle Spencer. I only have 5 minutes to do this. I could speak easily for the next hour singing Danielle's praises. She came to the MS program in narrative medicine in the program's second or third year. It was very, very early in the program's history, and it was only a matter of weeks, maybe even days, before I pulled my wonderful colleague Maura Spiegel aside, and we began brainstorming about how we were going to keep this woman with us forever. As you can see, our plan worked. Danielle has not only satisfied our expectations, but has far exceeded them. And as you are about to learn, she's written a book, Metagnosis, Revelatory Narratives of Health and Identity, that is sure to become an authoritative text, not just in the field of medicine, narrative medicine, but in the medical humanities at large. Danielle earned her BA in Studio Art Management from Yale University, where she was editor-in-chief of Yale Literary Magazine. Prior to entering the MS program, Danielle worked for 10 years as artist-musician David Byrne's art director. And after completing her master's in narrative medicine in 2012, Danielle taught for our program as an adjunct for 6 years, part of Maura and my genius plan, during the last 18 months of which she somehow managed to complete a PhD from Johannes Gutenberg University, Mainz, the dissertation for which has now become the book we are celebrating today. In 2019, Danielle became a full-time faculty member and associate director for the MS program. In the summer, this past summer, she became the program's academic director. She is a 2019 McDowell Fellow, a 2021 Yaddo Fellow, and co-author of our field's definitive text, the Perkins Prize-winning The Principles and Practice of Narrative Medicine. Her scholarly and creative work has appeared in Plowshares, Literature and Medicine, The Lancet, Aesopus, and much more. Today, Danielle will have a conversation with our other distinguished guest, Andrew Solomon, about metagnosis. So I know most of you are familiar with Andrew Solomon's work. He is a writer and lecturer on politics, culture, and psychology, a professor of clinical psychology at Columbia University Medical Center, and the former president of PEN America. He is also the author of The Noonday Demon, An Atlas of Depression, which won the National Book Award and was a Pulitzer Prize finalist, a book I have taught our students and which our students love. It has been published in 24 languages. He is also author of The Ivory Tower, The Irony Tower, Soviet Artists in the Time of Glasnost, the novel A Stone Boat, and Far from the Tree, Parents, Children, and the Search for Identity, which received the National Book Critics Circle Award for Nonfiction, as well as more than 25 other national and international awards. His print book, Far and Away, Reports from the Brink of Change, was published in 2016. It's a New York Times Notable Book Award. And most recently has made an award-winning film, Far from the Tree, in an audio series called New Family Values. And if you haven't viewed or listened, I highly recommend that you do. His writing appears frequently in The New Yorker and The New York Times, and he is often on NPR, and his TED Talks have been viewed over 20 million times. I'm going to hand the reins over now to Danielle and Andrew to talk about metagnosis.
Thank you, Craig. If I can just say a few words of thanks myself very quickly. Well, first of all, thanks to Craig, my dear friend and one of the founders of this program and academic director prior to me. I'm very grateful for everything you've done for me. And also Michael Gately, who's here, who's an invaluable member of our program team, and some of the folks at SPS, particularly Eric Nelson, who's a Senior Associate Dean of Academic Affairs, and Steve Cohen and Troy Eggers, and also our production team for events management, including Kira Stockdale and Liz Picard and many others who made this event possible. And of course, Andrew Solomon. Andrew, I am thrilled to be talking with you today. And right off the bat, I want to let everybody know that Andrew very generously agreed to be the co-advisor for my master's thesis project many years ago. It was 2012, but this it was this very topic. And Andrew, I can't believe that you agreed to do it because you were finishing this book, which you can see how heavy it is, and you know what a totemic book it actually is. But it actually hadn't come out yet, and you were in that final stage of helping it come out into the world. But I remember that we talked about how there seemed to be this incredible synergy between the topics that we were interested in. So it gives me an incredible amount of joy to be talking to you today. So thank you for joining us.
Well, aren't you extremely kind? It gives me a great deal of joy to see what has come of that project, which was in its infancy then, and to realize that I've been able to, if not help in any way, at least acknowledge and be aware of it as it has developed and unfolded. I think that the book is an extraordinary book. I've said some words of praise that I think have been or will be published on the book jacket, but I just wanted to say that it's really rare in the broad general field that encompasses us both to encounter something that is genuinely original. And this book is full of insights that I had never had before. Indeed, it describes an entire, I don't know whether the word is diagnostic, it describes an entire category of experience, diagnostic or otherwise, diagnostic in large part, and how it's played out in our society. And I think for example, Susan Sontag's Illness as Metaphor, it really changes the way that we think about things that we thought we knew all about. And so I don't have enough words of praise for what has been accomplished here, and accomplished, it should be added, in thrilling and readable prose so that it remains deeply, deeply engaging. I mentioned Susan Sontag. It also has some of the kind of riveting charm of an Oliver Sacks book. It really captures the experiences of individual people and then draws profound conclusions from them. So I begin with all those words of praise. And for the benefit of those of you who have not yet had a chance to read the book, I would ask Danielle that you both pronounce and define the word that is the title of the book.
Yes, when I was trying to convince my editor to let me use this neologism in the title of the book, I made the pitch that people will be so perplexed by it that then they'll have to buy the book. what it is. Yes, so it is a neologism. I took that liberty because doctors have done that through the ages, just taking Greek and Latin roots and putting them together willy-nilly. But it describes a phenomenon, which is when somebody learns that they have some kind of condition, and it's defined as when you're already an adult, you're into your life, and you realize that you have some kind of condition, and you didn't know about it before. And this can happen either because it was simply never diagnosed. So let's say you are colorblind, but it never occurred to you that the way that you perceive color is different from the way anybody else perceives color. And or it can occur because the diagnostic boundaries themselves have shifted. So the example that I begin the book with is David Byrne, who I worked with closely for many years. And he informally self-diagnosed with Asperger syndrome. But of course, Asperger syndrome didn't exist prior to that, certainly didn't exist when he was a child. And so the reason why metanosis is, well, first of all, there just wasn't anything that described it. I couldn't name it properly. And so here you have meta, one of the senses of meta is change, and as a prefix, and then gnosis for knowledge. So changed knowledge as opposed to diagnosis, which is literally through knowledge. But and the reason for that is that when people have this kind of experience, it often provokes, not always, but it often provokes a change in their understanding of these conditions and of their own identity. So it provokes a change in knowledge. So that's the genesis of the term. That's the definition.
Right. So talk about the way that David Byrne's experience with which you opened the book and your own experience, which you describe a bit at the beginning, but then in much greater detail later on. How were they parallel? How were they not parallel? And how did those two specific experiences define for you this category of larger experience that is metanosis?
Yes, so I started working with David in 2001, so it was past Talking Heads era, but of course he had imprinted on the psyche of many people during that time as the guy in the big suit, which if any of you haven't seen Stop Making Sense, you should just immediately watch it. And he was so frenetic, you know, he had such an unusual presence, such an amazing, brilliant, transformative presence. But people often wondered if there was something, if he had some kind of condition. And in fact, if you go back into that era and you look at some of the great critics, like the rock critic Lester Bangs, writing about him, they often invoked this notion of pathology. I mean, in a very positive way, but Lester Bangs wrote that Talking Heads were about the individual human unit's response to cybernation, depersonalization, the effect of corporate consciousness on individual identity, all those great contemporary questions nobody can seem to come up with any real or workable answers for. And in particular, when he was talking about David, he wrote that he has a withdrawn, disembodied sci-fi quality, and though there's something unknowable and almost autistic about him, he makes autism fun. And then Pauline Kael also invoked this notion of autism as well at the time. And so when I was working with him, people often asked me, what was he really like? And implicit in the question was this question. And so then he and I were both reading a great deal about Asperger syndrome as it was then described when it appeared in the mainstream media in the early 2000s. One of the key articles was a cover story for Wired magazine called The Geek Syndrome. And he felt that a lot of the qualities of Asperger syndrome were ones that he had, and he felt that he likely had the condition. And it didn't really go beyond that. I don't think he's ever had a formal diagnosis, and it didn't really change much for him. But I was really struck by the effect of this as a retrospective diagnosis, as something that then changes one's understanding of one's own life experience. And then some years later, I had an experience of this type myself with a medical condition, which is that I learned that I have a visual field defect that I didn't know about before. Similarly at the time, although that's quite different, that if that had been tested for when I was a kid, they would have found it. So it's not a matter of changing diagnostic boundaries, but it was still a very strange experience because from one moment to another, my understanding of myself changed dramatically, although nothing had physically changed. So that's the beginning of my interest in the project, were these two experiences that kind of connected with one another.
And talk a little bit then about how your experience of your strabismus, which was evident early on, and your experience of a visual field defect that you discovered much later on were different. And how would it have been if it had been the other way around in some impossible fashion?
Right. Yeah, I think that would have been impossible because the strabismus is a misalignment of the eyes. And so it's quite apparent. And in fact, that was just my normal. I always knew about it to the best of my recollection, and I was certainly affected by it. Although, you know, there's an aspect of that that is more related to the later revelation, which is that if you have a strabismus, then you likely don't have stereoscopic fusion, binocular fusion, the way that most people do, the way that the two eyes fuse the images into one and create so-called depth perception, which is a bit of a misnomer because there are many ways that we understand depth in the world. I didn't have that capacity. I still don't. I never will. That was something where at some point I grew to understand that, and it was an odd experience because of course my vision doesn't look strange to me. It's the vision that I've always had. But the visual field defect revelation was completely different because it just came, it came out of the blue. But then when I got it, it changed the way that I saw it, changed the way that I experienced the world. And in particular, I felt very vulnerable because I don't have conscious vision. That's a whole other story, but I don't have conscious vision on this side. And so all of a sudden I was aware of that. And so I felt very vulnerable, whereas I hadn't before. But of course, nothing had changed.
Right. Yes, I have dyslexia that was diagnosed when I was a child, but nobody told me about it, so I was unaware of it as a child. I have dysgraphia, which is really quite pronounced, and some depth perception issues, which were diagnosed much later on. And so I have some, you know, marginal attachment to this whole idea and this whole field of enterprise. And I think part of the question, and it's a question that you explore quite profoundly, is whether the perception that one has is then made tougher because you suddenly think, oh wow, I have a disability. That's a sad and pathetic thing to discover. Or whether it's a great liberation in which you think, ah, now I understand why certain things were always very difficult for me. And now I see the ways that I've been compensating all my life. And now I don't feel as sort of bewildered by myself or as frustrated by things that were difficult for me as I did before getting to a diagnosis. The book is, I mean, you look at these things from a very intellectual standpoint, but you also include emotional experience of your own and of other people. So perhaps you can address that.
Well, if it's all right, Andrew, how did you feel, if it's all right if I ask, how did you feel when you learned that you had these conditions as a child and throughout your life and that you weren't told about them?
You know, I think it would have been difficult to tell me that I had dyslexia when I was five, because I don't think five-year-olds can really understand or process what that meant. I didn't know that other people's mothers didn't spend 3 hours every afternoon working on reading with them. And I didn't know that certain things that I was struggling to do were difficult. And I sometimes think that if I had known that I had dyslexia, I might not have become an avid reader and writer in the way that I did. It's my whole identity, really, reading and writing. On the other hand, when I did find out that I had those conditions, I thought, oh, the fact that I read relatively slowly isn't because I'm, you know, a little dim-witted. There's a good reason behind it. And when I realized I had dysgraphia, which came later, I understood why my handwriting was always terrible. I understood why my parents always said to me that they wanted me to do well in school, but they couldn't care less how I did in handwriting. I was, you know, marked on handwriting all the way through elementary school, and I had a pretty good report card, but I had a C or a C minus in handwriting all the time. And once I had realized that, I gave it up. The only thing that I write by hand is my name. I, the other day, had to get someone to assist me because I had to fill out some medical forms and they had to be filled out by hand. And I find writing the most basic information by hand unbelievably hard. And at one point I thought that was kind of idiotic. And now, having learned more about the condition that I have, I'm able to accept it much more easily. And I'm unashamed in asking someone to give me a hand.
Well, it sounds like there are elements of liberation there, that having the knowledge is helpful in certain ways. You just beautifully describe the spectrum of reactions that people have. And I would say, yes, all of them. People have a wide range of reactions. And what can be confusing to people is they can have them seemingly contradictory reactions simultaneously, to feel a sense of regret that one didn't know before. Perhaps it could have been helpful. But then also perhaps relief that one didn't know before, because one has made adaptations, as challenging as it was. But actually, your handwriting grades, not to make light of this, but it reminds me of a friend of mine. Her younger brother was really good in spelling, and so he said he wanted to major in spelling in college.
Would that it were possible. There are places for people who are very good at spelling, however, even in our computer era.
But to finish, it speaks to the things that that affect us as children and when we're growing up. You know, of course, then we find a place in the world, and whatever our skill sets are in a different context then, which is typically very different from the second grade classroom. So that's part of it.
I wanted to turn to some of what you talked about in the book, and I'll start actually with this wonderful quotation from Schopenhauer that you use. I won't read the whole paragraph, I don't think, but you say, every man takes the limits of his own field of vision for the limits of the world. This is an error of the intellect as inevitable as the error of the eye, which lets us fancy that on the horizon, heaven and earth meet. This explains many things, and among them the fact that everyone measures us with his own standard, generally about as long as a tailor's tape, and we have to put up with it. It's wonderfully witty, Schopenhauer. It's him at his most charming, but it's also quite a profound comment on your topic. Tell me why you chose that quote and what it has meant to you.
Yes, so this is in the context of the story of my own vision, which I unfurl through three chapters and then relate it to many things along the way. But this comes at the beginning of a chapter that's called Half Sight. So it's kind of halfway through that journey. And what happened to me was that I knew that my vision was unusual, but then I had these further revelations about it and they kept unfolding. So first I have the strabismus and then I realize, oh, right, I don't have binocular fusion, but it's okay. And then in adulthood, I realize I have this visual field defect. And then after that, there was another revelation, which had to do with the fact that even though I don't have conscious vision here, I have what's called blind sight, which is unconscious vision, which most people aren't aware that there is such a thing as unconscious vision. Neither was I at the time. So when you put it in the context of that journey, and obviously, then relating it to other people's experiences and so forth, the point being that, we take our way of perceiving the world to be normative for us, right? Except that there's always, there's always another dimension that we can't see. There's always something outside of our field of view. And I felt that Schopenhauer quote, captured, and as you put it, very, very wittily, this tendency that we have to be totalizing towards others and to take them, to take our own field of view as being the limit of the world. And the challenge for us to try to engage in humility and true dialogue is to shed that affliction. But this is with a particular visual metaphor, with the parallel between intelligibility and vision, which is of course problematic, but it persists in the Western tradition.
It does persist, and people within the disability community are very frustrated by it. But of course, the use of all of the senses in both metaphorical and literal ways as descriptions of being awake to, aware of, engaged with the world, all of those persist. You have a section also in which you describe an interview between a doctor and a patient, and the patient has been paralyzed down one side of her body, but is in complete denial about it. And I thought it was an interesting way into the question of what is ignorance of your condition and what is denial of your condition, and how do those two experiences differ from each other?
Yes, so this also, to put it in the context of the story that I tell, is I'm exploring the idea of anosognosia, which is to not know that one doesn't know, but in the medical context, it's when people are unaware that they have a condition. And so I was exploring it in relation to my own experience, because of course I didn't know that I had this visual field defect. But it's not really the same as what the term implies, because it's really meant to describe people for whom, if you point out the quote unquote defect, I mean, it's just, all of these terms are highly problematic. Mm. But let's say somebody has a stroke and they have they can't move one half of their body. But if you point it out to them, they'll deny it. So that's an anosognosia. And in this case, this is from this is a passage from a book by Ramachandran, who's wonderful at unpacking neurological conditions and with a great curiosity. And here the question arises also is this neglect, as they put it, or denial, is it actually somewhat adaptive? And if it is, can we also understand that in relation to the gamut of human experience. Which if we zoom out, and Andrew, I'm curious to hear your thoughts on this too, because of course you write on these topics, that as we look to questions of illness and disability, in my view, one of the interests is that they're interesting for their own sake and we need to understand them better always. And also they provide us a different kind of perspective or illumination of the questions of identity in the body across the board.
Well, I think ability is always a relative term, and that the dangerous attempt that sometimes has served useful political purposes to distinguish between ability and disability has a sort of long and troubled history, and often results in our assigning people to categories without recognizing the nuanced nature of anyone's experience of ability or disability, in fact, for that matter. I was going to ask you to what extent you feel this book participates in the discourse of disability and whether you would see it as a text that could reasonably be taught in a class that was about disability or about narratives of disability.
Yes, I think so. I hope that the book does justice to some of the key concepts in disability studies and disability discourse, which need to be more widely understood. One way in that I take is through, well, Leonard Davis has this, who's a really important disability studies scholar and writer, has this notion of dismodernism, in which the subject, the human subject, who has some kind of impairment, is actually is not seen as the outlier, but is in fact the basis upon which we understand human experience. And the way that this relates to this topic is that, so I'm describing this phenomenon where, okay, you learn that you have some kind of condition, you didn't know you had it, but many of you who are sitting here, wherever you are thinking, well, but that hasn't happened to me. But the point is that it could happen to you. It opens the specter of doubt. And surely there are many things about each of us that we don't know about and that could indeed be understood as impairments or disabilities in different contexts. And so once that door is open, then I think that that provides an avenue into disability studies because it's changing the normative boundary, for normalcy, to be a little bit redundant. But we can also relate it to our current era because, now in this, during this pandemic, many people who consider themselves to be healthy, who are, in the words of many disability studies folks, temporarily able-bodied or temporarily able-minded, are experiencing a dramatic change in circumstances and vulnerability. I think it's making us all think about these questions in a different way. Obviously, I wish we didn't have to, but I hope that it can be a productive conversation.
I think the odd thing about the pandemic is this constant series of questions it brings up, which are endemic to what you've written about, but also very specific to this moment in time. Questions such as, am I sick? The testing is still not so readily available. People who are non-symptomatic don't tend to get it. It leaves all of us wondering all the time, is there something wrong with me or isn't there? Is whatever I have going to be injurious to other people? What are my social responsibilities attached to the condition that I do have or that I may have? And then finally, given the situation that I am in or may be in, what constitutes intelligent precaution and what constitutes absurd overkill? And how do I ever figure out what is necessary in order to act as a responsible citizen, given the situation I'm in? And what is it fair to expect from the society around me, given the situation that I'm in? Does all of that resonate with you?
Oh, absolutely, yes, because everything has changed so dramatically and the stakes are so high. And so we can't rest securely in our understanding of any of these questions. And so one way to connect it back to this, metanosis as I've thought of it is, you know, if you take a 23andMe genomics testing kit and it tells you that you have a higher than normal, whatever that is, risk of developing heart disease or particular type of cancer, then does that mean that you have a condition? You know, what does it mean to say that you have an increased risk for a condition? Well, these are completely unresolved questions, and we're in this time of radical change and transformation. I mean, the example that I gave, it doesn't have quite the social consequences as the ones that you just outlined, but one can't really rest on firm ground because we don't really know how to situate that knowledge.
Talk about the idea that you explore, and I'll let you explain it rather than doing so myself, but from Jerome Wakefield's work, the idea of the harmful dysfunction analysis.
Yes, so the phenomenon of metanosis unsettles many different understandings, or it has a potential to unsettle many different understandings that we have, ones that we weren't even perhaps aware that we were utilizing. So one of those is the question of what constitutes a disease. Now, if you're a philosopher of medicine, then perhaps you've given us some thought. The rest of us, maybe not so much. But one of the ways in which metanosis disrupts this is because if you're told, you have this disease, but you weren't actually aware of it, and it apparently didn't cause you enough functional impairment for you to have become aware of it, then the question of, well, so how is it a disease, you know, really, really arises. So Wakefield's harmful dysfunction analysis is a way of approaching the question of, well, what is a disease? And just to back up for a second, because you might be wondering why we would ask this question, here's a way of putting it. Why is synesthesia not a disease? Synesthesia is when people have strong associations between, for example, colors and numbers or colors and letters. Those are some of the common forms. I mean, it's not a quote unquote normal way of perceiving the world, and yet it doesn't have a diagnostic category for it. So why does it not, as opposed to something else like diabetes? It's an odd comparison, but anyway. So the Wakefield's harmful dysfunction analysis is kind of a middle ground disease theory, which says that for something to be considered a disorder, it must have both what he calls a failure of natural function, which is something that lies outside the norm of the species. But it also has to have, quote, some harm or deprivation of benefit to the person as judged by the standards of the person's culture, which is called the normative value criterion, which is that it admits into the equation the idea that it has to actually cause you some kind of problem. You see this a lot in the DSM, in psychiatry now. There's a shift to say, well, the such and such a condition isn't inherently a disorder, but if it's causing you some kind of problem, then perhaps we can call it a disorder. So it's a merging of the strictly biological understanding and then the more social constructivist understanding.
Right. I mean, I was very aware when my children were little, we were encouraged to do neuropsych testing. We were encouraged to do all of these things to try to assess whether they did have any challenges, with the idea that if they did, we would then be able to help address those challenges. In fact, I think neuropsych testing, you know, is an overwhelming experience for the children who go through it, even when it's done by a very capable and sort of warm-hearted practitioner. But it also provides a lot of information and leaves you constantly unsure where is the injunction to keep this, or sorry, the imperative to help your child to overcome a particular difficulty actually. Where is the imperative to help your child to function well despite having this particular challenge? And where is the imperative to say to your child, this is an area that will always be difficult for you, forgive yourself and don't worry about it too much. And it's very difficult to know as a parent. You get a lot of data and you don't get a lot to guide you through that data. Do you think that there are ways that we could arrive at greater clarity? I liked your questioning of the idea of dysfunction, or the other words that we've used that have a defect and so on, all of these words that are pervasive in this field. But what does it mean to actually decide that the thing the world would describe as a defect is just part of your character? What does it mean to try to overcome something that can't be overcome?
Yes, there's a lot to unpack here, but if I can get back to, you know, as a parent, I'm sure that you want obviously what's best for your child, like whatever that's going to be, you know. And so, but you're weighing so many unknowns, you know. Are you going to get some knowledge that's going to be helpful to the child? Is there something you could do that could be a benefit to them? On the other hand, if they have some kind of condition, is there a stigma associated with it? Or to your point, are you perhaps preventing them from coming up with their own or adaptation to whatever the condition is? You know, I'm reminded of, you know, one of the other diagnoses that's really still, you know, very contested, and people often have belated revelations about it, is ADHD. Certainly many people have benefited enormously from learning that they have the condition and that there are treatments for it. Very dramatic examples in the literature of people who just have this rapturous experience of transfiguration after they get the diagnosis, and then are able to have effective treatment. At the same time, you have a figure like Dr. C. Keith Connors, who's the so-called father of the ADHD diagnosis, who said, "I struck a match and I didn't know how much tinder there was around." Which is to say that the diagnosis just, in his view, you know, just burned way out of control. And there is these consequences of the diagnosis that that were not just salutary, but also, you know, had many other consequences.
Talk a little bit about the ways in which this book fits into the field of narrative medicine, which is the field within which you've been working for a long time. I mean, obviously, it describes medical phenomena and it tells stories. But beyond that most basic equation, what makes it narrative medicine, or in what way is it a departure from narrative medicine?
Yes. Well, I can hawk our book, The Principles and Practice of Narrative Medicine, for those of you who would like to learn more about the field. And Craig, who introduced us both as one of the co-authors alongside many of our colleagues in the Columbia program. Yes, I see it as an elaboration of some of the fundamental precepts of narrative medicine. The narrative medicine began as a way of practicing medicine, fortifying clinical practice with an attentiveness to the stories that patients' experiences, and understanding for clinicians to be able to better understand not simply the you know, the data that was being conveyed, but the form and structure of the account. But I think that the field is emerging, is evolving very quickly, and I and many others in the field are taking a more expansive and inclusive perspective towards this, which is to say that the role of the skilled reader or listener or translator is one that we must all occupy. And certainly those of us who find ourselves in the role of a patient, which is pretty much all of us, unfortunately, need to be able to bring these tools of nuanced reading and understanding to something like, for example, you know, a belated diagnosis of a condition. And it's done in partnership with the people in our lives and with clinicians and so forth, but to empower people to be able to read and understand these revelations alongside other forms of knowledge. So not just to take it as something that's then determinative. And I have to add that that's something that not everybody has the liberty to do, because it takes a good deal of privilege to do that. And people are objectified by diagnoses, and they don't have the freedom to say, well, okay, I may have this diagnosis, but this is what it means for me. My hope is that by expanding this, you know, through this particular phenomenon, to open it up and to show how there are different ways to situate it alongside other aspects of one's life, that will be ultimately liberating for all of us.
Well, I think liberation is a wonderful theme, because I very shortly, to my enormous regret, will have to cede the floor to questions from other people. I had about 32 other pages that had their corners turned down and that I wasn't able to get to. So when the disaster that is COVID is over, perhaps we can have dinner and I'll ask you all of them. But in the meanwhile, I would just say that often when you say my favorite part of the book was the conclusion, what you mean is that you were relieved to have finished reading it. But that is not what I mean in this instance. I think your reading of Roland Barthes in particular is very profound. And I think you end the book with a description of the ways in which the writing and the living of these experiences has ultimately conduced to freedom. So why don't you comment on that before we open up the floor?
Thank you, Andrew. Yes, the last chapter is called Freedom. And I put it in the context of, well, great many number of things. I'm sorry everybody hasn't had the chance to read the book yet, but hopefully this whets your appetite for it. Yeah, the last chapter I talk about metanosis as a form of metafictional diagnosis. I talk about the comedian Hannah Gadsby, the brilliant comedian Hannah Gadsby, as well as Maggie Nelson. And as these allied efforts to use different tools to try to liberate us from the constraining effects of a particular diagnosis or a particular identity construction or a particular genre or form that doesn't allow us to express ourselves in the way that we might, and to draw connections between the experience in medicine and healthcare, or between health and also experiences that we think of as being in, for example, literature or other genres, but to see them as allied. And how can we free ourselves and one another in all of these domains? Again, it's a very grand and lofty goal that I aspire towards.
Craig, do you want to introduce the questions?
Absolutely, thank you, Andrew. So I'm gonna call on Shelby Vitek first. Would you like to ask your question for Dan?
Sure, thank you for letting me unmute myself. I'm wondering, you know, since it's such a new field, how did you decide come to the narrative program as someone, you know, myself, I'm considering it as well. So what were you doing before and what made you decide to study narrative medicine?
Well, I was working as David Byrne's art director. So naturally this was the next thing to do. I wanted to always be doing something that people responded, you know, if I was at a cocktail party, people asked me what I do, and I answered that they would be confused and intrigued at the same time, and that would provoke an interesting conversation. No, actually, in all seriousness, I didn't really understand it at the time myself. I had a strong interest in medicine and medical culture, and I was intrigued by the ways in which it seemed like such a huge gulf between those who are inside of healthcare and those of us who aren't. And yet that seemed very odd to me because we are united by having bodies. And I thought that we could use some voices that are able to help translate. And then I learned about this field of narrative medicine. I didn't quite know what it was at the time, but it was intriguing. And then I learned that there is a master's program at Columbia. And I encourage anybody who's interested to email me and I'll tell you more about it. So I entered the field and I found that it is indeed an extremely dynamic field that's grappling with these questions of how do we get these discourses to communicate with one another effectively.
Thank you.
Thank you, Shelby. Deborah Starr, hello. You have a question?
Yes, I did have a question and I put it in the chat and it's kind of long, so it was more a pondering. Sorry, I don't have my camera on. Maybe I can get somewhere where I can turn. I'm not in a public spot. Can you want me to read it or do you want to read it through?
Well, go ahead and just ask it and either read it or just ask it in whatever way you'd like.
Okay, I just said in an expanded interpretation of disease as, you know, dis-ease, How might this topic relate to those who find later in life that they were adopted, or they had a surgery as an infant and not told till adulthood, or discover or it's revealed that they were sexually abused or otherwise traumatized, say a fire, evacuation, et cetera, as a child?
Yes, I think that the concept opens to many of these different understandings, and they are all very relevant. Just to take one, and I do write about this in the last chapter of the book, is a revelation about one's own heritage or one's own genealogy is something that many people are confronting now in this era of genomic testing. And so one example of that is writer Danny Shapiro, whose 2019 memoir called Inheritance, A Memoir of Genealogy, Paternity, and Love, tells about her revelation as an adult that her father was not her biological parent. And she finds the revelation to be absolutely upsetting and ruptures her sense of identity completely. And then she goes from there and goes to another place. And in fact, what happens is that this goes back to some meta-gnosis as a change in knowledge. You know, initially she says, well, my father was not my father. But of course her father was her father. You know, what she has to do is she has to renegotiate the terms of paternity as a relationship of care. And biology is relevant, but is not determinative, right? And so she gets this ancestry DNA test and she's given this genetic information, but she is then empowered to situate that in a different way and to understand that of course her father was her father. I don't treat the issue of trauma in the book just because it's such an important topic and it really needs to be addressed, I think, on its own terms. But I do think it's relevant, and I look forward to having those conversations about how that relates in terms of having a revelation about something that happened to you, and then having that conscious knowledge later in life, and how might one negotiate that.
Right. Yeah, I look forward to it too. Thank you.
Thanks, Deborah.
Thank you, Deborah. Swati, I'd like to ask you a question. You have a question that relates to Arthur Frank, who I believe is here on this.
Wow. This First of all, hi, Daniel, for the second time. It's really an honor to listen to you all over again. What I wanted to ask about is, so I've been reading Arthur Frank for a while, and I'm glad that he's here. I'm sorry if I am going to, you know, misinterpret that, so I apologize right from the start. But then there's this question that's there in the book, The Wounded Storyteller, that the desire for the narrative, the desire basically comes, is expressed for my body, with my body, and through my body. So it's just that the changes have always been there. It's that the illness, the suffering has been there, but it's just that the person who's suffering doesn't know the name of that illness. Or maybe doesn't know that this is the kind of illness that exists in the body. So after this knowledge, this sudden knowledge, how does the desire to express for the body, or how does this narrative shape, you know, this sudden knowledge about the illness, how does this change that is there once it's acknowledged help the writer to write about their changed bodies?
Well, actually, since we do have Art here, maybe Art, you can jump in a moment. But first, let me just make a distinction, which is that the metagnosis, as I define it, I took the liberty of defining it, is not a situation in which you know that you have a problem. Let's say you have a, you know, pain and you just can't receive a satisfactory diagnosis or treatment. In this case, you're not aware that you have a problem. Maybe you retrospectively become aware, you know, like in Andrew's case, oh, that's why I had difficulty in school doing these specific things. But in this case, there isn't a suffering of the body that's recognized as such. And this goes back to philosophy of medicine and the intersection between what Twaddle and then later Kleinman made as distinction between biological disease and the lived experience of illness, and then the social aspect of sickness. And usually one enters into this matrix by having a physical problem. You know, you have a pain or something like that. That would be the disease aspect. And what's strange about metagnosis is that you're just dropped into the Venn diagram without having had that experience of the body that you've recognized as such. And then it really, you know, this is where it casts doubt upon the designation of something as a disease, because it's supposed to cause some kind of physical, it's supposed to go back to Art's quote here, you know, the desire expressed for my body, right? So, but this is something that doesn't first arise out of the body in a way that people recognize as such. But Art, are you here? Would you like to jump in?
Hi, thank you very much. Now, I think you pretty much said it. I mean, what's really interesting to me about this question is the use of the word suffering and the way in which suffering requires some sort of reflective capacity, that suffering isn't inherent in whatever it is. Suffering is the quality of thinking about yourself with that condition. And I guess my question to you is, do some of your cases find that actually they began to suffer once this had been given a name, that what was just sort of the way it is, you know, wasn't a condition of suffering, it was just the way it was. But once it had a medical label attached to it, then all of a sudden it became something for which they would have said, well, I suffer from.
Yeah, well, I think I'm one of those cases because I found the revelation of the visual field defect to be really discombobulating. I wasn't aware of it before, so it didn't bother me before. But I have to say that in many of the cases that I examined, either through memoir or conducting interviews of people, on the whole, people were happier to have the revelation. And they would often recognize that they had been suffering, they just hadn't recognized it as such. So people who realized that they had had tremendous difficulties with, you know, attention, with ADHD or Asperger syndrome or the like, and so then they're often happy to have the knowledge. And so they've suffered before, they just didn't recognize it as such. But then it's not that simple, because then a different kind of more existential suffering might come after the revelation, because then often it provokes this necessity to reconcile the knowledge with one's sense of self. And it's not really a welcome thing to think of oneself as having, as being pathological.
We have several questions about the master's program. I'm going to encourage you all who are asking those questions to please email Danielle or me or Michael Gately. We'll put our email addresses into the chat box so you can please, I really encourage you to reach out. But I'd like to call on Gordon Dutton, you had a question?
Gordon, you're here.
I am, yes. Thank you. That's a fantastic presentation. My question was, you in the discussion, referred to what I think is the self-referencing criterion, which is used in business to highlight how those in their who use their own perspective are unlikely to be able to trade successfully with those of other cultures. And you highlight that this is a major issue in medicine. But in my experience, many clinicians are not really aware of this professional anosognosia in themselves. So how do you think this needs to be addressed?
Well, our entire field is dedicated to trying to reform one of the aspects of it, to trying to improve healthcare education. And in my view, one of the things that we can do is lovingly inject a sense of greater humility into this process. So, and it's not at all to denigrate the tremendous tools of diagnostic acumen and biomedical knowledge that the field has accrued. That's not my stance in it by any means, but to have some humility about the scope of those tools is a big project. But I think that metagnosis helps us a little bit along the way, because it really is poking at the inviolability of medical diagnosis. A, because these are conditions that weren't caught, and B, because the conditions parameters are constantly shifting. So it's a little bit tricky to make a claim for some kind of, for not to have a need to question if the field's definitions are changing. if that makes sense. But Gordon, I know that you yourself are a masterful metagnostician, as I call you, with a great deal of humility and an understanding and an appreciation of the primacy of the functional needs of the individual, right?
Well, thank you for the compliment, but yes, I think that has primacy. I think medical role stops at diagnosis for those people for whom there is no medical approach that can subsequently be adopted and needs to be replaced by a habilitation or rehabilitation role.
Yes, yes, very much so. Thank you.
You know, we are unfortunately 1 minute from the end of this wonderful event. Danielle and Andrew, any closing thoughts you'd like to share?
Well, just one thing, one practical thing is to buy the book.
Yes. How do we buy the book, Danielle?
Well, it should be out next month. The best place to find the links are at my website, which is daniellespencer.com/metagnosis. And unfortunately, the Amazon pre-order link is broken today, but it should be repaired shortly. And so you can find a way to purchase it. So thank you.
Great.
And I'll just wrap up by saying again, what a compelling book it is. I think that the quality of this discussion illuminates the ways in which it bridges a variety of fields and a variety of ways of thinking. It is scholarly and quite extraordinary in some of its scholarship, but also deeply, deeply personal. And I think that there is an elegance to the thinking that has been manifest in today's conversation, but that is Danielle's trademark, that really makes it all falls into place and it all makes sense. We've talked about a variety of what may have seemed to be slightly disconnected questions. When you read the book, they become part of a single larger set of questions that all hold together.
Thank you so much, Andrew, and you really were an inspiration for me in writing this. So it's a joy to speak with you today.
Thank you.
Thank you both so much. This has been just terrific. It's really fascinating to hear the two of you speak about the work, which is truly original and remarkable. Thank you all for coming. I hope you enjoyed the event, and please stay in touch with us.